Okay, so why don't we move on to Hiraman Tiwari, and then we will be able to thank them both at the end. But let's first clap to welcome Hiraman Tiwari.
Thank you very much, Chairperson Professor Parimal Patil. Let me begin by expressing my sincere and profound gratitude to the organizers of this conference, especially Professor Rohit Dhankar and his team led by Ravi Prakash, and of course to Azim Premji University, which has facilitated such an enriching academic program here at this infectiously attractive campus of NIAS. Let me also, before I begin, give you a couple of explanations or a sort of apology. Apology in the sense that I, after listening to this morning's beautiful presentation in Indian philosophy, starting off from Professor Phillips to, of course, a very mesmerizing interpretation by Professor Sundar Sarakkai and then Professor Patil, and this quite enriching interpretation, I now wish I had written a more philosophical paper. But given the topic of this conference, I thought I'll write something which you can at best call meta-philosophy, certainly not philosophy. Here it is. But one more thing, that there will be, like any other paper in Indian philosophy and literature, it will be sprinkled sometimes, maybe, you know, monsoon-like showers of Sanskrit verses and words. That's a warning to you, but I can also assure you that even if you ignore them, you don't need to get wet by these showers. There will be before or after translations, so you just have to ignore them as meaningless sounds. So I have translated them or lifted some translations from elsewhere. So these are two things, and then let me now say, Shemash Heaney, the Nobel laureate of literature, once wrote while analyzing the travails and vicissitudes of Osip Mandelstam that the great Russian poet in his prison days worked, and I quote, not with a pen, but with his moving lips, unquote. Because Mandelstam, and I quote again, had come to realize that a manuscript was more durable than a man, and that memory could provide no permanent sanctuary for poetry. From that sanctuary, nevertheless, it emerged with poignant force, unquote. However, Mandelstam's wife, Nadezhda, worked for the night shift in a textile factory. She kept herself awake by muttering the verses of Mandelstam to herself. And I quote, again, I had to commit, said Nadezhda, everything to memory in case all my papers were taken away from me, or the various people I had given copies to took fright and burned them in a moment of panic, unquote. Such a pursuit of protecting conversation, knowledge for posterity, for dissemination, perhaps is not unique to any single civilization. In early India, that is from the time of the Vedic literature, much of what has been preserved, and here I use the word preserved, the question was regarding memory, how do we go about it, owes to interventions and role of memory. It's a very difficult topic, not only in Indian philosophy, but modern political and theoretical discourse. I may have time to speak about it a little later, if I'm permitted with the time, but maybe not, because I'm saying other things as well, both individual memory and collective memory. Memory, therefore, becomes an important tool to reserve, retain, and further an intellectual tradition. For example, the Vedic verses, Samhitas, and their meanings, Pathas, were collated, discussed, and understood in an intellectual environment where all participants, teachers and students, and sometimes even the audience of that exercise were expected to retain the text and the deliberations on them in their memory to be able to pass that knowledge on to the successive generations. Now, this exercise involved both individual, as I mentioned earlier, and collective memory or memorization. And the commentarial text or meta text that is the text about text. And there are various levels of commentaries Professor Srivas has just mentioned. They're all meta-texts, by the way. Every time you read a text, you create a text. So whether you like to call it fixing a meaning or reading a meaning or deconstructing it, to use a fashionable term of modern times. So these meta-texts that were later produced, such as the Brahmanas expounding on the meanings and the purpose of the Vedic texts and the rituals suggested by them, and the Aranyakas, the texts ruminating on the objectives of Vedic rituals and life around these rituals. In other words, contextualizing them, were being generated to establish a strong literary tradition, philosophical tradition too. And I call them deliberately literary tradition, because all philosophical literature is, after all, literary literature. But of course, I am aware of the aesthetic aspect of literature too, around which meaningful human life could be envisaged. That is the purpose, and I'm not going to quote them. Later, the philosophical texts, the Upanishads, went beyond. When I say later, I have in my mind the two epics. So don't mistake me that, you know, these texts are, I mean, they are texts which Professor Srimas just mentioned, that, you know, the sutra style of composing or textualizing, if you like. So these went beyond a life of rituals and meditated upon the meaning of life itself, the discovery of the self, the body, the nature, and relationship between men and the world. And though these philosophical treatises, like the Brahmanas and Aranyaka texts, proclaimed to belong to the tradition of the Vedas, were often questioning the wisdom of the Vedic rituals and the life around the Vedic rituals themselves. This was a conscious effort, and I say conscious effort, to move away, or maybe create another tradition, to move away from the life of the Vedic rituals, to introduce an intellectual exercise ruminating on yet again the meaning of life and the world. The tradition of generating such meta-texts was concerned also with the dissemination of knowledge in pursuit of discovering identity and filiation to this and to the self within an existing tradition. It is a different matter, however, and I shall return to this, as I said, if I have time, that these texts and similar other often went, as in the case of the Upanishad, against the basic structure of the very text, that is Vedic Sanghitas, they were claiming to interpret and transmit. The topic that I'm introducing here is the conversation style of creating a text or undertaking an education system. So conversation and dialogue, that is purpose of generating knowledge. In his opening section, Pashpashanik, or the investigative introduction to his great commentary, that is the Mahabhashya, Patanjali gives reasons why one should acquire knowledge of word and shabda. Prayojana is being listed here, and he says, so what are the objectives of pursuing the ways of the world? I say ways of the world. Kani punaha shabdanu shasanasya prayojanani. Ways of the word, I say deliberately, rather than the word. In the process of arriving at this question, Patanjali also gives the possible meanings of a word or a speech. Then he enumerates the following, and they are listed here. Preservation of Vedic knowledge, that is raksha, by memorizing to recite correctly, samyak paripalayishyati. Contextualizing the Vedic speech, uha, adaptation, interpretation, attaching meaning, taking meaning, the Vedic speech. Yatha yatham viparinamaitabhyaha. Yatha yatham, whenever it is necessary and however you wish, you have to give meaning to a text. And the third, of course, is for conversation. The speech is essential for generating and preserving knowledge, agama. Knowledge for the sake of knowledge, if you like, for identifying the self, nishkaranaha dharmaha. And the next is felicity and economy in understanding, generating and communicating knowledge, laghu. you can call it brevity, economy of effort in that. So that for that too, you need knowledge or the source of knowledge. And of course, the last one in the big one is called clarity, freedom from doubt in generating and disseminating knowledge. Asandeha. That is avoidance of misinterpretation. Even when you attach a meaning, give a meaning, you must avoid misinterpretation. Asandehartham chadhyayam. One must study to remove all the doubts. In this most riveting conversation, Patanjali goes on to give further, more mundane reasons for acquiring knowledge. And these are, when I say a mundane reason, you could see what they are. But not to me they are mundane, but nevertheless. The next one is for acquiring respect, status in the society through command over knowledge. That is, te asuraha, he just gives one word that is explained further. For propriety, civility of conversation, avoiding inappropriate, incorrect speech, dushtaha shabda. For precision and focus in speech, yadadhitam anarthakam na. Whatever has been studied should not go to waste or is not without any prayojana. Ability to recognize the context and pertinence of the speech, vag yogavit, it's very important. For quelling ignorance, some of them are repeating themselves, avidvam saha. For correct application, pronunciation in conversation or conversation itself, vibhaktim. For commanding knowledge, padashaha, swarashaha, aksharashaha, vacham, vidadhati. You know all about the language. Ability to recognize the secret of the speech, parts of speech, that is chatvari. I'm not going to count them. Ability to recognize the self through the speech. For recognizing value, propensity of the speech. Bhadra vachi lakshmihi. Good speech brings not only name but also money. Lakshmihi. Or this, if you want to interpret it as Lakshmi. But of course, to be glory too. For avoiding embarrassing situations in speech. And the last one, which is my most favorite one. For naming a child. Dashamyaha putrasya. How do you name a child? How do you attach that meaning? Although proper nouns have no meaning, yet we expend so much energy in looking for an appropriate word for a newly born. Of course, on the 10th day, as he's saying. One can go on to discuss in detail how the ancient Indian grammarian explains the philosophical approach to knowledge, which is in his case, represented through the science of language. However, as we have noted here, Patanjali believes that conversation and communication, if mastered sufficiently, can bring about knowledge which is universal in nature and beneficial in a particular context. I shall, as I said, I might say more about it. Let me put forward my formulation, of course, of the objectives of learning and knowledge in the context of this paper here in this conference. Once we agree that communication and conversation are the foundation in pursuit of knowledge, we can legitimately raise a question, how and why knowledge? And that is, I call it why conversations or why knowledge? See, I would like to approach this question in three following formulations. There can be more or even less. They might be repeating it themselves. Even different ways to formulate this question, why conversation? One is, of course, education in need and everyday knowledge to facilitate life. Panini and Patanjali on why must one study the word I've just given you. The second is, of course, crisis of the self that elevates the entire conversation to a different level, which is conversation as rehabilitation of the self. And I'll talk about it. Arjuna in the Bhagavad Gita, Nachiketa in the Kathopanishad, Maitri in the Brihadaranyakopanishad. And the third formulation that I have done here is conversation for knowledge or knowledge for the sake of knowledge. Dialogic on the self and the context of the narrative, that is shifting from the Vedic ritual to the Upanishadic meditation. Now, that's how I look at it. I'm not saying that I have got it from a tradition, but of course you might find some of the subversive reading that I'm doing of this, and I'm doing it deliberately. We have seen how our grand old grammarian Patanjali approaches the process of conversation. The first five objectives, that is Raksha, Uha, Agama, Laghu, and Asandeha, refer to my first formulation here. Education needs socio-ethical, socio-economic, and socio-political requirements of an individual. Whether it is to preserve a precious resource, knowledge, or knowledge system, or economic activities, Patanjali suggests one must acquire knowledge. A and B, that is Raksha and Uha, above answer these questions. The next three, Agama, Laghu, and Asandeha, are directly linked to the preservation and interpretation of knowledge. Let me also suggest that Patanjali is inspired by the Vedic imagery of the creation of the universe, where the speech presides over it. In the 10th mandala of the Rig Veda, the speech has been described as the source of all conversation and expression. And I'll just quote one of them, as I said, you might have to suffer these verses. Aham Rashtri Sangamani Vasunam Chikitushi Prathama Yagyanam Tamma Deva Vyavadaduhu Purutra Bhurishthatram Bhurya Veshayanti. I am the word, and let me give you the slide, I think. Yeah, here I may have. Yes, there it is. I am the world, the collector of treasures, most thoughtful, first of those who merit worship. The gods have established me in many places with many homes to enter and live in. Through me alone, all eat the food that feeds them. Each man sees, breathes, hears the word I speak out. They do not know it, but yet they dwell beside me. Hear you all the truth as I pronounce. And then finally, verily I announce and utter the word that gods and men alike welcome. I have the power to make men mighty and can make one a wise and a sage. In other words, there is a text that is being created, and the text begins this pedagogy of creating a dialogue where the text itself comes and speaks that if you do that, I am there to help you out. So that is one system of knowledge in ancient India. And then comes, of course, this final pronouncement, in my opinion, for the paper, which says, further speech again says, on the summit of the world, I station myself. My home is in the waters, in the oceans, from where I extend over all existing creatures and touch even the high heavens with my forehead. So sitting right on top, so the conversation, the speech, the language, the communication is the first, as I said, foundation for any kind of knowledge system, if you like. I'm not necessarily saying the language as we speak it. There could be some other languages. So I'm not discounting, I'm not prejudicing this language or any language over any other speech or any dialectic or dialect, but just there has to be a method to communicate. Now, before I move on to my second formulation, which, as we shall see, is connected with the first and indeed suggested by these Vedic narratives, let me digress a little here and say that not only in ancient India or ancient Indian civilization do you have this notion of the creation of the universe through the mighty speech. The goddess, the ancient Egyptian and Judeo-Christian model of cosmogony, too, is quite conversant with the one presented by the Vedic seers. I'm not suggesting at all that all these models are similar, but if you saw the ancient mythological literature, you will be forced to think about the universal nature of the speech. Scholars have suggested two fundamental models of conception of the universe. One is called intransitive and the other is transitive. While the latter, the transitive, is commonly held by almost all great religious traditions, where a creator constructs or reconstructs the universe. But in the intransitive model, it is believed that the world comes up spontaneously without any intervention, out of a chaos of matter, if you like. And there the imagery is mostly constructed around a great churning of water, just like the pralaya in Indian mythological model of creation. I shall refrain from going into the Indian philosophy of cosmogony here, but will only point out that the speech, conversation, or communication has come to form the basis for generating knowledge, constructing knowledge. I shall also discuss below the commentarial and contextual process briefly of conversation as generator of a unique system of knowledge, which Professor Srinivas also mentioned earlier. Now, let us get back to the creation through speech in Egyptian model of the world. The hymn presenting that model is from the New Kingdom of Egyptian civilization. The German Egyptologist Jan Assmann quotes this poem on cosmogony in one of his writings. He came forth as a self-generated, all his limbs speaking to him. He formed himself before heaven and earth came into being, the earth being the primeval waters in the midst of the weary world. I don't have any purpose of trying to compare Indian with the other, only to suggest that there are models which are available, so this may not be unique to India, or it may not be unique to any other part of the world. There are fascinating accounts in ancient Indian religious texts and philosophical literature where the Vedic seers and later thinkers have spoken of the speech as a model for the universe. And the text that I began to quote with is that is the Mahabhashya on the Ashtadhyayi itself contains a verse which speaks about what it is that it is speaking about. In one of his recent papers, Arindam Chakravarti has suggested that participation in public language, since all language is public, requires relinquishing of privacy or exclusive ownership of one's ideas and sentiments. To speak one's mind secretly is to give up exclusive proprietorship of one's ideas and let go of one's feelings. Telling is letting others know what one has come to know of beneficial truth. The truthful and reliable teller is one who acts out of compassion towards others, unquote. It is in this context that I bring in my second formulation, crisis of the self, conversation as rehabilitation of the self. Let me illustrate it with the three most famous conversations in ancient Indian literature. First, the conversation between Krishna and Arjuna in the Mahabharata, or more popularly in the Bhagavad Gita, because the Bhagavad Gita is part of the Mahabharata, although somebody just questioned that it has become one of the Prasthana Trayas. That, of course, credit goes to Shankaracharya, but well before that, Gita was recognized as a very important tool to understanding the travails of life. And of course, the second conversation is again a very famous one between Yajnavalkya and his wife Maitreyi. And the third, equally poignant conversation between Yama, the god of death, and the young boy Nachiketa. I say the education in crisis, that you do need somebody to teach you, either you teach yourself or you need somebody. And these are the reasons why one must try and educate oneself. And the third, of course, as I said, for knowledge for the sake of knowledge. Although there are hundreds of such conversations, these are not the only three ones. And the entire literature of Sanskrit, whether it's philosophical and Dharma Shastra, this all based on these conversations, removing of doubts. And some of the practices were discussed earlier in philosophical context by Professor Stephen Phillips in the morning, that this is how the Tarka becomes a very important tool to learning. Let us quickly remind ourselves that one of the legendary communicators of ancient India who engaged and enraptured hundreds and thousands of people was, of course, the Buddha. The entire effort of the Buddha was to engage with people, and sometimes, if you believe the scholars, he caught hold of certain Brahmins and sat with them and communicated. Communicated in many ways, not necessarily very high philosophical texts, but very mundane conversation, and through which he drove his point, or either drove that Brahmin away, or that Brahmin converted, depended entirely on the conversation and absence of obduracy in that person who came to converse with the Buddha. So he is one of the best communicators, if you like, and therefore he has become the best teacher to me. Closer to our times, Mahatma Gandhi too was phenomenally effective communicator. In fact, some people say he was an infectious communicator, an engaging talker and a soothing teacher. However, I shall restrict here my discussion only to the three communications I have mentioned, because I have also the limitation of time. This is the Vedic speech in ancient India is believed to have been revealed to those who had the power to see. A seer, Rishi, is one who can visualize the Vedic mantras, the efficacy of which is confirmed by the imagination of the seer. Such a seer also has vivaksha, the desire to articulate. Professor Stephen Phillips says that you need that person, apta purusha, must not only know it, but must be ready to communicate it, pass it on as faithfully as he has learnt it or as he can, I'd say. So that seer has a vivaksha, the desire to articulate, communicate his speech. In this way, communication produces text, and the production of text could normally emerge through three different agencies yet again. That is, human agency. A seer, a knowledgeable and wise person, produces religious, philosophical, and ritual texts, and of course, no body. So, and that, of course, is Veda as we know. There is no body. And it is revealed and it is treasured, for it issues forth from the imagination. But the desire to speak, or vaktum iccha vivaksha, cannot apply to the last category of the text. Although it is assumed there that, you know, eko ham bahusyama sa icchata. So that's a different topic altogether. This is the traditional view on production of the Vedic text. But the intervention of imagination and context provide legitimacy to its meaning. My point is that even though the Vedas were not written by anybody, they were revealed, but there has to be an agency which is full of imagination, which eventually provides legitimacy to the text. So what is the agency of such a soteriological literature? Some have suggested magical efficacy. Others explain the agency of the imagination in the production of the Vedic text, for it guides the lives of ancient householders and priests. One is the efficacy of the mantra, and we know that a mantra is that which is arrived at through contemplative practice and is believed to have the power to effect the change, and at that, desired change. Production of knowledge through magical efficacy is reified by its meaning and transmission. Therefore, much emphasis was placed on the meaning of the Vedic mantras, because communication and transmission cannot take place in a vacuum. It is a continuous process. Every time a mantra is applied in a ritual, it goes through a degree of transformation in its spatio-temporal boundary, which determines the meaning for the householder and or the priest. This process of meaning is not an innocent activity by any chance. It is conjoined with ritual efficacy. In almost all ritual practices, the meaning is closely tied to focus and power of will and the imagination. It is imagination again which propels efficacy of the ritual. Imagination, I quote, is more important than knowledge. And knowledge is limited. Imagination encircles the world. That is the famous quote from Albert Einstein. And imagination is another term for transfer of meaning. Again, we are harping back on assigning meaning, appellating meaning, giving meaning. Whether this transmission of meaning takes place through translation or through conversation in a classroom. One can point to the history of transmission of two literary and philosophical terms in Sanskrit, that is bhavana and kalpana, to underline the contextual analysis of a text. Bhavana is a term which the Buddha was very fascinated about. And of course, the Mimamsa defines it, bhavana nam bhavitur bhavana nukulo bhavaka vyapara visheshaha. So in that context, bhavana is very, very important for our imagination. I thought I was going to eat into his time, but nevertheless, I'll stick to that, yes. Now this Therefore, then, I mean, I've been warned by the chairperson that there is not much time left. So I'll again follow other speakers and skip to certain other pages. But the let me say that the let me go back to at least recount the third point that I formulation that I made, that is the crisis of the self, conversation as rehabilitation of the self. Every conversation does not yield answers, much less solutions, but it requires imagination to be performed effectively. Indian texts, both literary and philosophical, have mastered the art of conversation. One of the most, as I said, enduring conversation in the ancient Indian texts is between Krishna and Arjuna. This is a text of communication in the times of crisis. Why do I say it's a time of crisis? Because you could see Arjuna is absolutely depressed. He's suffering from an absolute, what you say, condition of nervous breakdown. Otherwise, he won't say, Asidanti mamagatrani, mukham cha parishishyati, gandivah sransate hastatvakshaiva paridahyate, nachashaknum vyavasthatum bhramati vacha memana. These are all, if you go, and let me give you a quick translation and then I'll perhaps close. Gripped by extreme sorrow, born out of compassion and fear, Arjuna stammered before Krishna, seeing these relatives of mine ready to fight in the battle, my limbs are benumbed. I feel, I'm not making up any words. Sidanti mama gatrani, my limbs are benumbed. I feel, I'm translating but not at all making up any, I'm not subverting by the way, Gopalji, that I feel dehydrated in my mouth and a shiver is running through my body. My hair is standing on its end. My Gandiva bow is slipping off my hands. My skin is burning with the heat of fever. I cannot stand on my feet and I'm feeling desperately giddy. This is a clinical condition of a person who is absolutely suffering from a nervous breakdown. And it is at that time that Krishna, he says, Trahi mam tvam prapannam. Now I have fallen at your feet, please protect me. And then emerges, and let me say that in this context, I would also like to suggest, because he has gone, the education in crisis is something which is very closely related, as I said, with a very powerful theory of humiliation in social sciences, which my dear senior colleague in JNU and a very kind friend, Professor Gopal Guru, has started and writing about it. But that, of course, I'm fully aware that this is rooted in a different contextual analysis. Nevertheless, you could see whether it is devotion, whether it is education in crisis. This, you have to be humble. You have to be ready to humiliate yourself from a certain level to learn. Now, the other two conversations, I'm not going to mention because, but we all know perhaps the conversation between Yajnavalkya and Maitreyi, and of course, Nachiketa and the God of Death, where the God of Death was forced to write his own autobiography, in my own words, if you like, in Kathopanishad, because nobody can speak better of death than the death himself. No, so in other words, the education, the philosophy of education, as I began by saying that it is a meta-philosophy, the philosophy of education is something that we need to formulate why we need it first, and then how we acquire it. Thank you very much.
Take them at the rate at which they come then.
I seek forgiveness for this question being, I think, may sound very trivial, but it's a genuine question that I'm putting forth. It is that your presentation gave me a sense that all that is speech and, I think, language. And hence, I could not understand much. And I think you, I know that you are a historian as well. So can you help me that why I'm not able to understand? Maybe, can you say something on this? And also whether my understanding that, my interpretation that you want, your presentations was like all that is speech, is correct or no?
I'm not sure. I mean, you can't expect a speaker to hear a worst comment that I don't understand it. Nevertheless, I also understand why you may not have understood it. The idea was, of course, because the conference is about education and philosophy of education, my focus was mainly why and how to, first of all, what is it that we want in education? And from philosophical point of view, in Indian philosophical point of view, it is the knowledge. Now, if that is, you know, agreed upon that we require knowledge, then about that knowledge, what is it that we need to do? And my formulation was to theorize what the knowledge is and how we acquire knowledge. And language, of course, I said two or three times that I'm not speaking of a particular language. I'm talking about a method of communication. And of course, there has to be a content when you want to communicate. How that content needs to be communicated. From ancient Indian texts, of course, they use these very obtuse, opaque terminologies like jnana and other things. But of course, when you unravel it, open it like that mat, you'll discover what that jnana is, jnana of something. So obviously, I don't know whether my answer at all takes you anywhere nearer of trying to understand. But I'm sorry that if you haven't understood.
No, you need not be. That's what I'm saying. It might be because of the position that I'm here in. Through this education that I have got, I'm just hypothesizing. No. Maybe I'm not able to understand this language of the Vedic text or whatever. So do you have to comment on this? That's what I meant to say. One is my own cognitive...
No, I get the point. Yeah. See, of course, the topic itself is very different.
If I may, perhaps you might take 2 minutes, and maybe would one of the other dialogues help you answer this question or not?
Maybe just
2 minutes, because there are other questions, but that might help.
See, the conversation that I talked about, the education in crisis, learning in crisis, communication in crisis. I began by saying this first example of the very famous one. There's nothing new about it, we all know it. What I was saying here is that there is a time when people are confused, they don't know what to do, and this is the situation of Krishna, of Arjuna at that time. The reason being that he's driven by the desire to have the kingdom by winning the war, and then, of course, he thinks, how am I going to do that? And of course, he thinks that is only possible by killing his own kinsmen. Once he has realized this, suddenly he is gripped by this fear. And of course, the entire Bhagavad Gita is full of that. That is one conversation. The other is, of course, the conversation between Maitreya and Yajnavalkya, where, of course, it begins with the very common conversation of this, whether if the entire wealth of this earth belong to me, will I still be happy? Now, this is how the subjects are introduced in Indian philosophy. Upanishadic texts begin with a very mundane conversation and very quickly move on to what we understand as a very spiritual philosophical text.
I think this seems to have triggered a number of questions, which is good. So would you like to take a few at a time?
Yeah.
Okay. Why don't we get these two? I saw Professor Gopal Guru and then one in the back here. So those four first.
It would be to distinguish genre. And this comes back to an earlier worry we expressed about the Brahma Sutra. It seems to me that the Upanishads are a very distinct genre from the Brahma Sutra, and that whereas the Upanishads are not straightforwardly concerned with truth that is common to us all, that is intersubjective. You know, there are lots of jokes in the Upanishads, false etymologies, analogies, and these conversations, I think, are meant to be polysemantic, and suggestive. Whereas the Brahma Sutra, I think, the idea of fixing a meaning instead of extracting a meaning is actually wrong, and that the great Sanskritist George Thibaut, I think, cogently argues that Ramanuja is right and Shankara is wrong in their respective readings of the Brahma Sutra, and without the notion that the Brahma Sutra is actually trying to get at the truth, it makes no sense to try to argue that the one interpretation is better than the other. Whereas if you take the different, very different genre of the Upanishads, the idea of, oh, there's just one right reading is just nonsense. That, you know, that these are texts that are aimed as a kind of meditational method and, you know, are to be appropriated by different people.
Let's get a few questions.
And there's no question there, I know. Yeah,
I know.
I was only going to agree with you, except, let me just say, except that. No, let me just, because I'll forget, because except that this, although the genre between of the Upanishad and of course the sutras are different, but there is no denying that both of the commentaries of both of them are very conversational. That is the dialogic, the question and answer, Purva Paksha and Uttar Paksha. That is one thing. It is true that, you know, the Upanishadic texts can become lighter. Yes, go ahead, sorry.
We'll take a few in a row. So yeah. One here, and then I saw Professor Gopal Guru, and I saw one in the back, and one over here. So we'll take four.
Thank you very much, sir. A few clarifications are required. First is, can you differentiate between dialogic knowledge, knowledge in dialogue, and Upanishadic mode of communication? The two words, dialogic knowledge and Upanishadic mode of communication, are in your abstract.
Yes.
And third, I am introducing knowledge in dialogue. So is there any difference between them? First. Second, is all communication dialogue? If not, then what kind of communication qualifies as dialogue? This is second. And the last
I think it would be good if you kept it to just the second. Because let's keep moving, otherwise we'll never get to the others, if that's okay. You can ask the third one later. Okay. So let's pass it to Professor Guru.
Thank you for your consideration. I want to just make a very quick point. This is a very general point. I must thank Hiraman for giving me an opportunity to underline the pedagogical importance of your speech. It's a pedagogical concern that what do you want to teach the students in the school or in the colleges and the universities? Do you want to teach philosophy the way Plato taught, Plato suggested, or Kierkegaard suggested? Kierkegaard always said that I don't want company, I necessarily walk alone. No, I don't want history, I want to walk alone, philosophy. Your comments, sir. And we are facing problem in this country because we are separating from the so-called, we want to remain like a lotus, and therefore we require mud. Is that the philosophy we are teaching in this country? Plato would always want to, in the dark cave, stay there. I am there to provide light for you. You don't come out from the dark cave. This is not philosophy. Therefore, we want Buddha. Buddha went out to meet all people, engage them in honest conversation. I don't need to really quote Richard Rorty for honest conversation. And I don't want to really quote Heba Maas for communicative competence in the background of Aruna's concern. What are we doing? And we are so much ignorant and innocent about our own resources in India that we want Buddha to go out, meet everybody from Amrapali to every Lichha to everybody. Engage with people. We have that kind of tradition. We want democratic tradition to make knowledge available through critical thinking. What are we doing? And therefore, we have to listen to Hegel and Marx. Oh, you guys never had any kind of serious philosophical thinking. And who is responsible for this? This Agrahara Chiri thing has to be broken. That's why this is what, which is not there. Anyway, thank you very much.
I have two more hands, I think. There's one here. Yes,
please. Sir, I would like your comment on a quotation from Bible. In the beginning there was a word, and the word was God.
I have two short questions.
Efficiently, like, please, yes.
I'll just stand up. I think you can't see me. So the first is, sorry, I entered the presentation a bit late, so if I have missed something, just correct me if I am wrong. If I understand you correctly, like all this conversation, like education, as you're saying, is somewhere related to conversation and it's related to speech. So if you are denied the possibility of speech, are you also denied the possibility of education? That is something which was, it seemed, was happening at that moment, you know, when we are talking about those ancient times. So like speech as a political act, like speech as something which is political, is what I'd like you to comment on. And just one small, another small thing is, you said education for, like, in times of crisis, like, you know, conversation in times of crisis. But what about conversations in times of certainty, when people are very certain of their knowledge? What if you just want to comment on that, if what does, so I'd just like to have your insights on that, because this is not something which you talked about.
All right, I saw one more hand, and then we're going to have to stop the questions, and I'm sure the answers will have to stop short too. But
very related to the text, the meta-text kind of thing, where the text speaks to us. So one of the things I also am grappling with is when people are seeming to have dialogues in the Upanishads with the non-human, not as revelatory, but there are these children who go to the forest and he learns from the bull and the cow and the kham Brahma, etc. So the whole, especially in the Chandogya and the Brihadaranyaka, you find a kind of, especially in the Chandogya, you find a dialogue with a non-human. And that non-human, the text seems to interpret for us as a revelation. The text is telling us what, or the child tells the teacher, this is what I learned, and therefore there's this whole dialogue with the non-human itself in the form of sort of, you can say, a dialogue with nature or a dialogue with the enworlded condition of the person. So I would like you to comment on if you've come to any conclusions about that.
Let me start from the last one here. Again, the first of all, the Upanishads, of course, is a didactic text, although it is in a very conversational, light way that it is communicated, but it becomes very, very intense at times. Now, how it began is more fascinating to me. It begins with a very, very, very simple questions. As I said, the questions of Maitreya to Yagyavalkya about economy. And you would be interested to know that Amartya Sen, in his book, that is The Development as Freedom, he begins this book with this quotation, that this is the economic concern that people can have to live a good life. And of course, the concern of Maitreya was that, will I be happy? Now, it is the happiness that is more important. And that is what is important in the Upanishadic speech or even other commentarial speech, that whether you, what you have discussed, what you have learned, what you have communicated with somebody, whether it has brought you any kind of benefits. The last one, of course, is knowledge for the knowledge's sake. And also one of them is, of course, I had quotations, I said, unfortunately, I don't have time. It's a long paper. It has that objectives of a speech, that it gives you instant pleasure. It gives you money. It gives you how to speak well, that I have described here. So the conversation with the non-people, I'm not very sure whether the Upanishad envisaged in the way that they are non-people. There is always a target. Upatsyatehi mama kopi samana dharma kalo hyayam niravadihi vipulacha prithivi. This is Bhavabhuti saying, Ram is saying that even if people don't understand me today, someday, somewhere, there will be a person like me who will appreciate it. So some of the Upanishadic conversations are like that, not necessarily directly between the two people. I don't know. I haven't come to any conclusion why it is. It's just that when it is, that's why I give these three formulation: knowledge for the sake of knowledge, so then Pollock, the language of the gods in the world of men. So that is one, of course, pedagogy of the language, Sanskrit language. But what I was saying is that, you know, you need a medium to communicate, and that medium to communicate can come about in 3, 4, 5 ways. As I said, I'm giving you three, there could be many more. The way I analyze them is looking at the context of whether it is the Mahabharata context, the Bhagavad Gita, or the Upanishadic context, that these are somewhere you simply have a conversation for the sake of conversation, somewhere you are interested in getting something. Now that leads to Professor Gopal Guru's point, and it is a comment, and I take it in a very, very, you know, positive spirit and grateful for that. That I tend sometime to read into text, and that's why I kept insisting that I do not mind giving meaning to the text, because every time I read a text, I believe I'm creating a text. And that when I say I, anybody could. So the commentaries are just that. Otherwise, what will be the meaning of sutra? We can go on talking about the teacher might have explained this is the meaning of aham brahmasmi. Now, I don't know, God knows that these students, how they distorted the meaning and presented that. So there is, of course, they propound that it is a methodological system of retaining the meaning. But in the process, the meaning is given and attached, except in the case of Nyaya, where things are very, very clear. Of course, that there are two kinds of meaning, as you know, you didn't have time to discuss. I thought you were going to discuss Samayikaha Shabdartha Sambandha, and of course, Siddha Shabdartha Sambandha. The relationship between a word and meaning is given. That's what some people will believe, Mimamsa and others and grammarians. And Nayayika said, no, it is constructed. I'm not saying conventional. Constructed meaning. Samayika Shabdartha Sambandha. Normally it is translated conventional. That I have, but if I have learned from Professor Patil that this is what it is, and that is Samayika. But it is not necessary that he has necessarily got it from somewhere. He might have given it. It acquires a meaning. Now that, of course, so I'm very thankful to you for this kind of reading and for encouraging me for this. Now, about the Bible, I have studied it, but what can I say? That's why I said I was not interested, except two quotations, I was not interested in comparing the two. You can go on comparing, there are so many verses that one can, and let me only quote my favorite poet, Tulsidas, in his Ramcharit Manas says, this is how I had ended this paper, I don't know, it might change. Jane binu na hoi paratiti, binu paratiti hoi nahi priti. Unless you know something, you don't trust it. And unless you have a trust, you obviously cannot be attached to it. So the attachment, of course, must become from apta, the trustworthiness. And the last one, of course, sorry? It's the time, okay. But the only thing is this question is a dialogic knowledge. And knowledge as a dialogue, there is a distinction in literary theory, but it's a long one to elaborate here. But of course, you could read them as one, if you like, in a particular context.
I think we're very fortunate. It's tea time, so some of these conversations can be completed then. But please join me in thanking everyone for a great session.